ज्ञानानंद परम शिवोऽहम् ॐ नित्यानंद 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 परम शिवोऽहम् शिवोऽहम् ॐ नित्यानंद परम शिवोऽहम् ॐ नित्यानंद परम शिवोऽहम् ॐ नित्यानंद परम शिवोऽहम् नित्यानंद परम शिवोऽहम् ॐ 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 नित्यानंद परम शिवोऽहम् नित्यानंद परम शिवोऽहम् ॐ 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 नित्यानंद परम शिवोऽहम् नित्यानंद परम शिवोऽहम् ॐ 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 शिवोऽहम् ॐ नित्यानन्द परमशिवोऽहम् ॐ नित्यानन्द परमशिवोऽहम् ॐ नित्यानन्द परमशिवोऽहम् नित्यानन्द परमशिवोऽहम् ॐ 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 नित्यानन्द परमशिवोऽहम् नित्यानन्द परमशिवोऽहम् ॐ 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 नित्यानन्द परमशिवोऽहम् नित्यानन्द परमशिवोऽहम् ॐ 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 नित्यानन्द परमशिवोऽहम् नित्यानन्द परमशिवोऽहम् ॐ 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 नित्यानन्द परमशिवोऽहम् नित्यानन्द परमशिवोऽहम् ॐ नित्यानन्द परमशिवोऽहम् ॐ नित्यानन्द
नित्यानंदेश्वर समारंभां नित्यानंदेश्वरि मध्यमां अस्मदाचार्य पर्यन्तां वंदे गुरु परंपराम। I'll continue to expand on the 18th verse of Isavasya Upanishad. Agnena yasubhataraye asman vishvani deva vayunani vidvan yuyot yasya मज्जुहुरानमेन भूयिष्ठां ते नम उक्तिं विदेम। लिसन ओ अग्नि द फायर गॉड नोयर ऑफ ऑल अवर एक्शंस एंड ऑल दैट इज वर्थ नोइंग यू मस्ट टेक अस अलॉन्ग the righteous and auspicious path of completion, leading us to experience the supreme consciousness, the original space of complete completion. O God, consciousness, may you remove all our incompletions that are obstacles on our good path of completion, beyond coming and going, birth and death, unto you. We surrender with many reverential words, bowing down again and again. Listen. The first part of the verse I explained, the best prayer you can do is lead us to, take us along the righteous and auspicious path of completion, the original space of complete completion. The next line, O God, consciousness, may you remove all our incompletions that are obstacles on our good path and completion, beyond coming and going, birth and death. Understand two important sacred secrets you need to catch in this verse. One, listen carefully. The first, innocent surrender. Please understand, I am not saying ignorant surrender. Ignorant surrender means you do not know what is surrender, you do not know to whom are you going to surrender, you do not know what is going to happen after that surrender, you do not know what is going to happen if you don't surrender, you do not know the original concept of surrender. Just trying to throw away your responsibility in the name of surrender is ignorant surrender. Innocent surrender means you know everything and you don't have insecurity inside about going through this path. That is innocent surrender. Understand the difference between these two. I'll explain. I have seen the hypocrisy of human beings in any 10 level. People come and tell, Swamiji, I surrendered everything at your feet. In the end of the one-day program, during energy session, please cure my cancer. I tell them, all right, stay for 2-3 days, I'll heal you. No, tomorrow morning I have to go for my work. See the stupidity. No, I surrender to you, you heal now and send me for my work. Extreme hypocrisy. Here, the person doesn't know what is surrender, doesn't care about what is surrender. He is using the word for some bargain. Innocent surrender means you have a thorough idea what is surrender, to whom are you surrendering, what will happen after that, what will happen if you don't, what is the right context, everything. You know the whole thing and you do not have the fear of transformation it is going to bring inside you. Understand? You do not have the fear, the transformation it is going to bring inside you. What is exactly you are afraid? With surrender, suddenly your own taste about life may change, which you are afraid of. Oh God, I may suddenly start liking something else. Then what will happen to all the things for which I worked for 10 years? What will happen to that house which I brought designing, which I built designing every room? What will happen to the car which I bought enjoying the mirror, side mirror, front mirror, clock, these, that, so many things? What will happen to all that? Suddenly my desires may change, my fears may change, my thinking may change. Understand, when you mature, your desires do mature. If you decide your desires should not get matured, you stop your maturity. You stop your maturity. Maturity of the desires and fears is what I call renunciation. Renunciation is not denunciation. Understand? In Hindu tradition, Vairagya is not Aragya. Viraga is not Araga. Renunciation is not denunciation. Maturity, getting added to your desires and fears. Understand? You might have heard thousands of conspiracy theories. I give you the worst conspiracy done against the humanity is creating a fear in people about the possibility of their desires getting matured. Understand? There is a worm sitting inside that small shell. And if you frighten that worm, hey, if you become butterfly, how will you eat? Here at least your food is guaranteed. Inside the shell itself you have a food. And nobody can attack you. If you become butterfly, how will you save yourself? What will you eat? I tell you, trying to suppress human beings without letting them taste off-the-grid life, off-the-grid life, is the greatest conspiracy. I tell you, all the best things India has, Sanatana Hindu Dharma has, is by the rebels who learned to live off the grid when they were young. When you are young, learn to live off the grid. The powerfulness that brings inside you, after that, even if you are hooked to the grid, grid will be at your feet, not you will be at the feet of the grid. After that, nothing can bind you. I am glorifying all this by wearing them, not getting glorified by all this by wearing them. I am decorating the throne, not decorated by the throne. I just want to make a statement to the world. All these traditions of Hinduism need to be revived, relived, enjoyed, cherished, spread, enriched. Because this tradition taught taught me to live off the grid. And no society is more compassionate in the world than the Bharat Indian society, which loves, respects, reveres the people who decide to live off the grid. In any other country, if you decide to live off the grid, it is illegal. In this country, decide to live off the grid, the people will wash your feet and give you food. I am waiting for my Balasans to become 18. First batch I am sending to live off the grid. That is going to be the grand finale for my Balasans. And in the March, all the Krama Brahmacharis and Naishthika Brahmacharis are going to enjoy the off the grid life in March. I have plans. All the Krama and Naishthika and the ashramites are going to enjoy off the grid life in March. Now I tell you, fear of your desires getting matured will stop you getting matured. Any society frightens its people about maturity will kill itself. Let more and more maturity be added. Let your desires get matured. Your fears get matured. If you are afraid of death, and suddenly you are afraid of the karmas which may hit you after death, don't think you are in the same state. You have become matured. You are no more afraid of death. Only the karmas which may not come after death. Then your whole life, you will not be planning for more and more locks and bigger walls. You will be planning about completion. If you are afraid of death, you will be planning for a greater and greater wall and lock. If you are afraid of the karma, you will be planning for more and more completion. So even your fears getting matured is a growth. With surrender, the first thing you will experience is your desires and fears will get matured. End, they will completely disappear. That is different. That is the ultimate experience. But the moment you start practicing surrender, your desires and fears will start getting matured. Your anxiety, your fear, whatever emotions with which you are struggling, your incompletions, all these will start getting matured. You may not have incompletion with the people who are living with you or with the day-to-day life. You may have incompletion with incompletion itself, that why I am not able to complete you. That can never be equated to the incompletion you are having with the next person, because she did not smile at you or he did not smile at you. They did not respond to you. They poured water on you. Your incompletion about they poured water on you is totally different than your incompletion about incompletion, that why still you are not able to complete. I can say here, even your incompletion and anxiety has become more matured. See, ultimately this incompletion will disappear. That is experience. But even maturity shows the growth. The moment you start practicing surrender, the first thing will happen to you is maturity in your desires, in your anxiety, in your fears, in your greed, in your everything. I tell you, live with the people who are matured. You will love the life. You will love the life. This whole prayer, you see, such matured prayer, matured surrender. If you are surrendering to somebody to save your life or to have 2 square meal, it is stupid surrender. You are becoming slave. If you are surrendering to somebody asking for enlightenment, leading you to beyond coming and going, birth and death, that is matured surrender. Even in surrender, there is maturity. The context, understand? That is why I always insist. Some people use me only as an orphanage head. Very few use me as the head of a monastery, Guru Mahasannidhanam. Understand? Your surrender, your fear, your anxiety, your desire, everything will get matured the moment you start practicing surrender. Surrender smokes out all your hypocrisy. It just smokes out all your hypocrisy. You simply know what is hypocrisy. You simply know why you are hypocrite. First reason why you are hypocrite is the fear implanted in you by society about your desires getting matured. I have seen people telling, I am afraid to come to the ashram. I may just settle down there. Hey, you think then we are all fools? You are blessed if your desires can get matured and you can settle down here. It's only the people whose desires were matured can settle down here. Otherwise, I have enough Bhuta Preta Ganas to pour water on you. And kick you out. The moment you say, I'm afraid to go and attend inner awakening, I may stop drinking. It means what? Fear of your desires getting matured. It is exactly that warm feeling. If I become butterfly, where will I get my food? How will I protect myself? I heard many big worms will try to eat me. Hey, just become butterfly. All these problems won't even exist in you. Making your old problems redundant, not solving. Redundant is renunciation. They just become redundant to your life. The more and more practice of surrender will more and more smoke out the hypocrisy with which you are hugging. Cuddling with hypocrisy is not cute. Understand? Hypocrisy is not cuddly bear. It is cuddy bear. Not cuddly bear. Cuddy bear means the bear going to bite you. Don't cuddle with your hypocrisy. No. Celebrate your desires getting matured. Celebrate your fears getting matured. Celebrate your anxieties getting matured. Celebrate your decisions getting matured. Celebrate your vision getting matured. You will celebrate surrender. Because in real surrender, spiritual surrender, the worm is becoming butterfly. The other day I saw a Facebook posting. A worm and the butterfly, both of them are sitting on the table in restaurant. Worm says, "You have changed in 1 month." Butterfly says, "Yes, Nityanandohum effect." Yes, Nityanandohum effect. And that photo was really a lot of meaning. The worm, in front of worm, there are food items. In front of the butterfly, nothing was there. The snake form of Kundalini in Mahadeva's form denotes surrender. Understand? Each item in Mahadeva's form represents one idea, one truth. Snake represents the Kundalini Shakti, which is surrendered to Mahadeva. Or I can say Mahadeva's own Kundalini Shakti, which is under his control. Innocent surrender means you know everything about surrender, but you don't have fear. Ignorant surrender means you don't know anything about surrender. You just use that word for bargaining something. Here you can see the innocent surrender. What a matured prayer. O God, consciousness, may you remove all our incompletions that are obstacles on our good path of completion, beyond coming and going, birth and death, unto you we surrender with many, many reverential words, because we don't know any other words. We only know the reverence we carry in our heart, and we don't know how to verbalize it. So we offer that as it is, bowing down again and again. Bowing down again and again. Understand, when money gets added, your taste about life changes. When power gets added, your taste about life changes. When name and fame gets added, your taste about life changes. When surrender gets added, maturity happens in you. Understand, the biggest change you can have in your life is maturity. I'll explain the difference. When money gets added, you have a new desires, new way of thinking, new fears, everything, but that does not mean your old desires have gone. They become redundant. Does not mean your old fears have become redundant. When name and fame gets added, you have more desire, more fear. That does not make your old desires and old fears redundant. When power gets added, you have new desires and new things. That does not mean the old is redundant. But when maturity gets added, constantly the old desires and old fears are becoming redundant. Whatever is today your desire and fear, tomorrow it will become redundant. And tomorrow, whatever is desire tomorrow and fears you have, that will become redundant day after tomorrow. Constantly, the old desires and fears becoming redundant is what I call maturity. That is what is renunciation. Renunciation is not denunciation. It is just making old redundant. They are no more part of you. They are no more part of you. Ability to make old desires and fears redundant is the ability to keep life alive. If you have that ability, you can make disease redundant in your body, boredom redundant in your mind, suffering redundant in your emotions, pain redundant in your relationships. At one point, you will become redundant due to enlightenment. Ultimately, you will become redundant. That is enlightenment. Making things redundant in your life. Making things, places, people redundant in your life. When you mature, the people who all the time talk about share, clothes, car, bank balance, your net worth, they become redundant to you. And I have seen these stupid NRI parties. All the time these donkeys talk about only this. The moment they gather, what is the share? What's the car you are driving? How many swimming pools you have in your house? How many bedrooms you have in your house? Do you have a tennis court? Make all these people redundant in your life. And when these women gather, oh God, NRI women, sari, jewelry, kitty party, make all these people redundant in your life. When your taste changes, they become redundant. When you get matured, they become redundant. The innocent surrender, where you know everything about it, you are not afraid of it. I tell you, the fear of maturity is the worst fear taught to humanity. This is the biggest conspiracy done against humanity. Attack on your body is chemical agriculture and pharmaceutical companies. Chemical agriculture and chemical medicines is the attack on your body. Overly sex and violence based entertainment is the attack on your mind. Fear of the maturity is attack on humanity. Understand, I am neither revolutionary nor rebel. I am just evolutionary. Maybe I can coin a new word, revive evolutionary. Even in the prayer, what a maturity. This one verse, I feel there is so much to tell about this verse. That's why I am not moving. Maybe the first day of the inner awakening, I will start the Kenopanishad. February 4th. The next beautiful Upanishad, Kenopanishad. Agnenaya Supadaraye Asman Vishwani Deva Vayunani Vidvan Yuyotyasma Juhuranamena Bhuyishtam Denama Uktim Videma. What a prayer! What a prayer! The moment I read this mantra, I can see the whole bioenergy becoming alive. If you want to pray, I think this should be your prayer. With the clarity, even while you pray, Sohamasmi. With this prayer, the Upanishad leads you from impersonal relationship to personal feeling connection. You can always just cheat yourself with just some good ideas, concepts, but never connecting to the source. This verse does not allow you to do. This verse really awakens that feeling connection. Essence of today's satsang, innocent surrender, not ignorant surrender. With this, I bless you all. Let you all radiate with integrity, authenticity, responsibility, enriching, causing, living Shuddhadvaita Saivam, the eternal bliss, Nityananda. Thank you. Be blissful.
Nityananda, I welcome all of you with my love, respect. I thank all of you for taking your time and come to today's session. Shining in the limelight as one of the most desirable celebrities undoubtedly brings a twinkle in the eyes of many. While those who have already achieved that strive to keep it alive, we are going to meet someone who has chosen otherwise, from celebrity to a sannyasi. Today we are going to meet someone who has stood up as a paragon of real Hindu feminism, making the very idea of male chauvinism redundant through her powerful life. Someone whose every decision powerfully impacted society's ideas of gender equality, which is just confined to mere cerebral opportunities. Starring in more than 100 movies in 4 languages, her stardom was in its pinnacle. And at the same time, she became a target, anti-Hindu terrorist who held a knife at her neck and blackmailed. How she responded back shook the whole world. A woman who stood up with an impermeable inner space. In today's world, issues like domestic violence, sexual abuse prevail, a common happening. Millions of women struggling to bring a change, striving to see a difference. We are still in a place where empowerment has been regressed into mere cerebral opportunities and not the freedom and change in its true sense. A powerful inner space. The world needs a breakthrough, a revolution in everything to pioneer change, raises a leader, a rebel. Revolution. A power. Awakening of Shakti. Parashakti. For the world tree, Parameshwar himself has descended.
Hara Hara Shiva Shivanu Reshwaraya Shivatara Swara Priya Lingeshwara Bhutanada Shiva Nandana Priyaya Sakala Loka Sarva Sakshi Swarupa.
Logic, words are his power. Woman is emotion, her breathing is her power. Understand? Chaste breathing is a command given to cosmos.
To behold these very words of Paramashiva as a testimony of true chastity stands Manityananda Vaisya. The year 1992 marked a turning point in the life of young Shri. Still in her adolescence, she had already decided to shoulder the responsibility of her family. 17-year-old was diving NFO to enter into the world that was unknown to her. Handpicked by one of the legendary directors of Indian cinema, Bharati Raja, in his Tamil movie. The same year, she made her debut in Kannada and in the Telugu industry too. Her courage and charm was persuasive enough for her to garner people's love and quickly rise into fame as Ranjita in a very short span of time. Her dedication, passion and love for her work drew her to span in more than 100 films across 4 languages. Touching the peaks in every language, she was rooted with many top directors and actors. Her presence on screen was magnetic. It soon garnered her the Nandi Award in the year 1996. Touching the pinnacle of success in cinema led her path into advocating tirelessly to bring out positive change for women and became an ambassador for various NGOs and started volunteering in various organizations for various causes. Achieving the best in a very short span of time, manual her life in seeking, coming face to face with our bodies. His divine goodness, Bhagwan Shri and the Parishma. By 2009, his divine goodness was already a huge phenomenon for the youth. He was just 30, but already millions by then had realized that he was an avatar, a beacon of spiritual knowledge. Who could translate the difficult sacred texts as practically applicable solutions in the modern world and giving it as a direct experience? Millions were drawn to him from worldwide for his mission, passion and hard work. And Ranjita was one of them. In a place that was known for fastly progressing toward healing, Swamiji's proactive contribution to humanity and Hinduism posed a threat for many who believed Hinduism was going to face extinction. Intolerant of Swamiji's hard work, the huge mission getting established in all its glory. Extremists and anti-Hindu terrorists devised a malicious attack and decided to use Ranjita as a weapon, one of the worst ever persecution executed. More than 100 assassination attempts on Swamiji. While this vicious attack made many believe that the whole mission has come to an end, what took humanity by a shock was Swamiji not only revived his mission partly, and his worship of millions worldwide as a supreme pontiff of Hinduism, leading the 2 billion Hindus all across the globe. But also his commitment to Ranjita as a guru, despite the attack and spiral that occurred, while many were still struggling to fathom the extent of Swami's compassion, made heads turn around with awe and support, the innate strength, the determination, courage and self-respect of a powerful, chaste woman she decided to fight
back. Especially not when you're threatened with arrest for something you've not done.
Yes, I am not the person in the video. Yes, I know. Like I said, when I'm threatened with arrest and when there are bigger powers that play and I do not know how to handle them, basically. I'm a very ordinary person who minds her own business, who goes to work, comes back home. That's it. That's my limitation of society. Because the forensic lab says I cannot take on something which is not true. I cannot be a Galileo. Galileo is a great man. He recanted on his faith, on his beliefs, because the church put pressure on him, but I am not. I cannot go based on a forensic lab report. I know it is not me, and that is what I'm sticking to. I cannot change it, right?
He rose from the ashes, reborn again. That's my demise. Tradition of sannyas was a tight slap to all the abuse. He established an unshakable commitment to work. Today she is an unparalleled inspiration for women worldwide, standing as a true testament for Swami's mission. Very committed. Dedicating her life to Swami's mission, she had formed these various projects to serve humanity. An acharya taking Swami's teachings to the world in multiple languages, including English, Tamil, Hindi,
అనుకునేదొకటి జరిగేదొకటి ఇంకా అంటారా అనిపిస్తుంది.
విత్ మోర్ దెన్ 200 వీడియోస్ ఆన్ యూట్యూబ్, అ మెంటర్ అండ్ అ గైడ్ సపోర్టింగ్ థౌజండ్స్ ఆఫ్ లైఫ్ విత్ స్వామిజీస్ టీచింగ్స్ అండ్ గైడింగ్ టీన్స్ అండ్ యూత్ అండ్ విమెన్ విత్ లైఫ్ సొల్యూషన్స్ ఫర్ ఇష్యూస్ ఫేసింగ్ ది యూత్. A healer walking people out of problems by using the powers nature gives them. A Shri Mahan is an official representative of his divinity, an icon of Hindu feminism heading the Shri Kailasa United Nations Global Initiative for Feminine Empowerment and Gender Equality. A beacon of integrity, chastity, strength, courage, dignity and inspiration. Showing women the beauty of discovering their inner strength and potential. Just through her hard work, perseverance, endurance and conviction, she stands to me as a testimony for the beauty of feminism. Powerful in your space.
Today, this moment is way too special for me, because the person who's going to be coming today to share her life's journey, coming to the public life at the mere age of 17, and her celebrity life just going at its pinnacle, and her decision to take sannyas, and more than all, personally, she's way too close to my heart. As a mother, as a sister, as a best friend, as a inspiring woman that I look up to, and so many youth today look up to. I'm more than honored to welcome Manityananda Mai Swami, and as Akka, whom all of us call as.
Manityananda. Actually, I'm just too excited. I'm sure Ma Tatyapya has already given all that we all could talk of. But having this opportunity today to directly talk with a person whom I idealize as one of the most, how a woman, a disciple, can be the best to her guru. I'm sure I'm just 18 years old now, and I still have lots of dreams about how we all want how our lives to live, how I want my life to be with Swamiji, how I want to be part of Swamiji's mission. And I'm sure, like me, all the other sannyasis and all my sister disciples in Gurukul have. And Ma Nityananda Mai Swami, whom we all fondly call as Akka, is that one person whom we all look up to as what a woman can stand up and what she can do by being a part of Swamiji's vision. Just with our devotion to Swamiji, what is a strength and what all we can achieve in life. I've heard about Draupadi, Akka Mahadevi, Rani Padmavati and Jhansi Rani, many others. But when I saw Akka, I realized they were all not just stories. The innate strength those women had, the devotion and the chastity they were established with, I saw it as a reality with Akka. So I would like to welcome Akka Maa Nithyananda Vaish Swami here with us today. And I would like to start this auspicious moment with offering of my gratitude to Swamiji with prayer.
Nityanandam paramasukadam kevalam jnanamurtim dvandvatitam gagana sadrisham tattvamasyadilakshyam ekam nityam vimalamachalam sarvadi sakshi bhutam bhavatitam trigunarahitam tadgurum tam namami.
Nityanandamma.
Nityanandamakka.
First, it's been so,
thank you so,
so
much
long since I saw you. It's like so, it's such a lovely surprise, and I really feel, I mean, if I could virtually hug you, consider this as a virtual hug, for one for you and one for Tattva Priya.
Thank you so much, Akka. Actually, here, I'm more than excited, because not just me, I'm sure all of us as Swamiji's daughters and Swamiji's own princesses, so many questions and so many visions that we all have, how we want to stand up for Swamiji's vision. And all of our questions today, we got a chance to ask you. And I'm here like as a voice of all of them. So I'm so excited to have this conversation with you, Akka.
Thank you so much. I'm so touched, and I want to tell you, it is such a charming presentation of myself that Tattva Priya has really presented. I've never been presented in a better way and in such a charming manner. Thank you so much.
I have a lot of questions to ask you from all the walks of your, all the different dimensions of your life. Like right from as a young girl, how you were, to a sannyasi, now like you're literally like a mother for many of us. So I have a lot of questions to ask you, but I would like to start off from childhood. One dimension I would say that not many still know of. So like starting off, you were born as Srivalli in a normal middle class family. Then you rose into fame as Ranjita, a popular celebrity. And then you made heads turn around by becoming a sannyasi, Maa Nithyananda Vaish Swami. So a middle class girl to a celebrity to a sannyasi. Life for you has seen all phases in extreme and in a very short span of time. And I would say it was more dramatic than any well-scripted film. So personally, what made you pick these choices? Was it your family pressure, or was it because of your passion? Or would you just call it destiny?
The destiny is what you decide to be, and that's what I firmly believe in, and it always stayed in my mind because one of my very favorite authors, Ralph Waldo Emerson, had mentioned it in some book, and I believe it and I also live by that. What you decide is what you become, and that's what Swamiji also teaches. So anything, my choice or my decision to be an actor was mine, though it was due to family's circumstances and family financial quagmire that we were at that point of time. When the opportunity to act in films was presented, I was around 16 to 17 years old, and I thought, okay, given the, I had to weigh out the options of what was the best choice for my pre-monastic family at that point of time. And being an actor was, it was like another job. You would study, go to an office, you know, work for 5 years or 10 years. It was something like that that I had chosen acting. It was like, okay, let me do it for 5 years. If I like it, I'm going to continue it. If I don't, at least, you know, I can move forward, do something else. It was based on that.
You were just 16 when you made this decision. Like, when I was 16, I didn't even know much of. Of course, I was with Swamiji, I knew lots of powerful cognitions. But taking responsibility or standing up, that was something too far for me. But you were just 16, and you never thought you will miss your childhood or your friends. I mean, generally, at least like I have Swamiji, so that I had kind of the right context, powerful cognitions, etc. But given that you had not even met Swamiji, you were just 16, and you never thought like the fun that people have when they are young, especially teenagers, you never thought you will miss all of that?
No, probably because I was more of a person who would read a lot of books from a young age. That was the one and only habit I had throughout my life, was reading books. So I never thought going for work would actually stop me from reading books. On the contrary, I had more time to read more books. And at that time, actually, when we were making the decision, it was based on, basically, I had only one thought current at that point of time, was my pre-monastic family, especially mother. Though father was around, it was my mother who was providing for all of us. I still remember her day used to start at 3:30 a.m. She would finish her prayers, wake up three of us. We were three sisters. Three of us, send us to school, cook for us. And in fact, many days when we were preschoolers, she would come to school to deliver lunch. And in between, she would go out, sell pickles. She would go home to sell pickles so she could make money to provide good food and have the capacity to send us to good, decent schools. And especially in the early 80s, a girl child being given a good, decent education was a priority for many families. So at that point of time, I think that was just when the face of educating the girl child has started changing, but not as dramatically or as dynamically it became the 90s or the early 2000s. It was still very much limited. A girl's education was limited, that she would be learning some vocational arts. She had to learn to speak good English. She could cook. She could play the veena. She could have dance. And maximum you could do was learn home sciences. I think that was the most preferred program in bachelors and schools, because it was more for the wedding market that the girls were being educated, rather than, you know, for financial empowerment. But in our case, mother was on the, I think she was very progressive for her upbringing. She was a very rural woman who was brought up in a very rural, improvised village kind of setup. But her vision for her three children was they should have the capacity to be financially independent, so they can make their life's choices without having to depend on someone, or because they are not having financial freedom to make their life's choices. So given that, mother had worked. I have not seen her actually take time off or go for movies or go to friends' houses. I've never seen that. So when our upbringing itself was not that, I even did not have the idea of like what you said, going out, having fun with kids.
But your choices of movies, Akka, you, so when I was actually going through in Google, I saw that you had done, like, in a very, very short span of time, you easily covered more than 100 films. And it was not just one language. You did in Tamil, Kannada, Telugu, and Malayalam. And you had, like, back-to-back-to-back releases in the same year. So how was that for you? Like, just at 16, you were so workaholic, actually. Like, so many, like, literally even now I can see that any instruction, any vision Swamiji gives, I always see how you always will be so inspired. And you have been very workaholic now. But at that time, just 16, what was your passion? Like, what made you be so workaholic and do back-to-back projects like this?
At that point of time, I never actually thought of that I was a workaholic. But when I came into the Adhinam and I look back, you know, many times when I look back, I would see that, like what Swamiji says, what you learn from life is what you become. So when I started working at that age, I think that was the best thing that can happen to any human being, is you start working young, because you only think of work as a life. You don't have any parallel methods of in recreation. I only remember work is worship, work is worship. The only other passion I had was reading books, like I said. So other than work being worship, I don't think I have any other cognition of life itself. So that was only now I realized that was such a good habit I picked up. Whether it is they started working because of this family circumstances or because my entire ambience actually in the film industry, if you see, only people are hardworking who sacrifice their personal likes and dislikes for what they have chosen as a life's choices. Only they become successful. And there is a very contrary belief in the among the public and in general understanding that in films you don't need to work hard, you just need to look good, and you know, it's not that. In films it's much more harder to have a breakthrough, to have success, if you are not integrated and highly dedicated and disciplined. So I learned that from all my seniors, whether it be the respected and the most inspiring actors, Sri Shivaji Ganeshan, or my seniors like Ms. Kushbu or Revati, all of them I have seen, they're highly disciplined and highly dedicated. And all the stories I've heard from the moment I entered into the film industry was of high dedication and simplicity and integrity to work, whether it's Ilaraja sir or Bharat Raja sir. I have seen them from morning 6 a.m. They would work tirelessly to fulfill what they are passionate about.
Great. Akka, actually, when you were sharing about your contrary, every choice you made, like even sannyas. So, all your choices, in all your choices, was your family supportive or did you have to be a rebel? This is a question that I always had. Did you have to like fight for it or, you know, be very strong, or were your family very supportive about it?
No, I think, like I said, one good thing was I don't think in that age we even had the idea of children rebelling against the parents. Because at least ambience was not like that in my pre-monastic family. And second, two things, Ma, I've seen always with parents who have two priorities. That is, the happiness of their children as a first priority and the belief they have brought up the children the best way, and they are smart enough to make the right choices, then the parents do not interfere. It is when the parents are not completely confident, I feel, about the children and their ability to keep up their choices, that's when there is a lot of conflict and there is a lot of rebellious attitude in the family. And also, it's also the child's integrity to the decision she takes, how she is able to convince her parents through her sheer integrity and dedication to whatever she takes, just will just change your parents' perception of your life's choices. And anyway, for the first thing of me being as an actor, like you said, it is such a dramatically different life choices. For me, it was like 360 degree turn. And but since it was due to financial circumstance of the family, my parents were extremely, actually I would like to say, I mean it's not a nice word, but my especially mother was so grateful that, you know, there was someone who could step into the family and take on their financial responsibilities and ease the burden for the family. And for me it was, like I said, my only decision making factor at that point of time was that mother should have a good life, at least towards her old age. She should not have to struggle or suffer. So given that, when you're very clear, when your intention is very clear, there is no conflict of what you do.
But you being a woman, like especially when you shared, right, like your mother was the only person who was supporting the whole family. So especially as a single woman, literally it was like a single woman who is running the whole family. And it was three daughters. A mother would be too protective. But the like as far as I know, the lifestyle in film industry is something that is completely different. So how were you able to balance it, or how were you able to maintain your integrity in that field? Like was you being a woman never an obstacle in that field?
I'll tell you one thing, I have never had such questions from so many reporters in my entire life. But I'm not really in fun of you. I find it so interesting the way you kids come up with these questions. Especially, before I answer this, I really want to tell you, when I first came to Adinam and I was seeing how Swamiji is bringing up the Gurukul children, I was so jealous of you kids. I was like, God, I wish I was just a Gurukul kid. And anytime I was like, okay, let me just, you know, be reborn as a Gurukul child and life would be so much easier. I was so jealous of the way Swamiji was bringing you kids up. And every second word or third, whether it's in satsangs or anywhere, you know that, you know, he'll say, oh, they are my future, they are my best kids and they can give the best to the world. And the principles of what, with what powerful cognitions he was bringing up the children, I think that is the best gift humanity can ever have. I think I've shared with you earlier also, how Swamiji is teaching you all to live and make life choices without fear or greed. That is what is going to make us live without suffering and violence. So, okay. as relating to my industry days and as an actor, like I said, coming from a conservative family, we always have ideas of how the film industry is. But God's grace was I had some of the best co-actors and actors whose focus was on the career and not a personalized agendas of movie making. And of course, my mother always used to come with me wherever I went. I don't think I have ever traveled anywhere in my entire years in the film industry without mother or one of my family members with me. I think, so well taken care of, protected by the family, that I did not even have a doubt that or insecurity that I'm alone. So, and what added to it was I never got addicted to any of the things that people talk about, whether it's alcohol or drugs or smoking. My family being with me and one of the things my mother taught me was the only, what I have seen her was any problem she would only go to pray. She would not become upset, she would not become, you know, cranky, she would not shout at us, she would pray. So I think that is something I picked up from her, and that was another thing that really helped me balance out all my careers, ups and downs, my personal conflicts, whatever I had. But other than that, if I have to compare my career in the films, I think it was the best, the best anybody can ask for, because I had some of the best co-stars who were extremely caring and made me feel at home.
Akka, when you were sharing about like every aspect of your life, you have had lots of success. So now this really brings me to another question, because especially when you are sharing about how Swamiji brings us up in the Gurukul. Actually, I remember when from the moment I joined Gurukul, never really, I have met lots of people have been successful in their fields in their life. When I go and share Swamiji's teachings with them, I've met a lot of them. But I've also, on the other side, met lots of people who are struggling in life. So I had the blessing of, you know, sharing Swamiji's teachings with them and bringing a difference in their life. But one thing is, after meeting Swamiji, never, there is literally all these words of depression, all of that, none of them has ever been in my life. I don't even know the meaning of it. When people talk about it, I don't even know what it means. Like, I've never been exposed to that kind of a thing. But never in your life, right, you are very successful in all the choices you made. What turned you to seeking? Like, what turned you to meet Swamiji? Because I would say by 2009, Swamiji was a huge phenomenon for the youth. All of them in Tamil Nadu, like, if you see the video clippings, literally so many youth, even now, many of us literally admire Swamiji, like, how, what we all know as God, the most coolest way a God can ever be. So, Swamiji was already a huge phenomenon for the youth, and he was just 30, but already within millions of people already realized that Swamiji was an avatar. And he was a beacon of spiritual knowledge. And Swamiji was giving so many sacred texts as practical, applicable solutions to the modern world. But your career was world apart, because you had your own fan clubs, you had back-to-back films, many were successful, you were literally in the heights of your career. How did you have that inner call, if that's the right word I can put? How did you have that inner call to meet Swamiji? Is it because you were always seeking for it? Were you always a very spiritually inclined person? Or how did that whole thing happen?
I think the best answer I can give is refer to one of the Shastras in Skanda Mahapurana, which says, in Uttarakhanda, it says clearly, I think verse 280, it says, a disciple finding the greatest guru is only through the previous birth's punyas. And once we find such a guru, we are freed from the bondage of worldliness. I think that's the best description, because seeking is not something I was even intentionally looking at. I never, you asked me about 10, 12 years ago, would you ever become a, you know, what is your life's goal and mission? I never would have thought being a monk or a nun or a sannyasi was anywhere in my periphery itself, not even be a consideration. And given that, I can only attribute that, because I have no other great reasons where I can say I've been blessed in my life with as being a Swamiji sannyasi or even as devotee or even a Swamiji's disciple. I met Swamiji in first 2009, and I was by that time looking at directing films. I had written several scripts and I had narrated a few of them to a few actors in Bombay, and I had almost my whole cast ready, my entire crew and cast was ready for my first directorial debut, which I was planning to start in October 2010 was the approximate time we were planning to start it. So, but despite this, you know, my at that point of my time, my life's goals and vision was, you know, make meaningful cinema through which you can add value to people's lives. And that cinema should be taken across to world international film festivals. And my dreams were all about my dreams, my conversations, my dialogues with myself and my friends would be, oh, the Sundance Film Festival. Okay, did you see the Oscars? Okay, this is how we need to get, this is what we need to do to get into the Cannes festivals. So this was my limited conversation, not even God or spirituality. But even though on one side I was having this larger goal and vision in life, there was something in me that told me, okay, this life, you know, yes, I am running behind my dreams. I am doing what I feel I should be doing. But somehow I was not completely complete with those decisions, because I felt this human life, there is something more that I needed to do, rather than just run behind my dreams or satisfy my ego. There is something I'm missing. There is some larger picture of what I was missing. And I could never pinpoint or even find what it was. In that sense, yes, I understood that as seeking as your higher self, when I heard Swamiji mention recently in a satsang that every one of us seek for something unique in us, and that is only seeking. That is when I started thinking back and putting and mapping it to what Swamiji said, I understood that as seeking. But at that point of time, if you had asked me if I was seeking, I would say, no. I mean, why would I do it? I mean, I was happy. I had a great family. I had a great friends. I had a great career. But yes, in that sense, absolutely, I was seeking to achieve something more, do something more unique, which we could leave behind for the next generations.
Even though your seeking led you to Swamiji, like you beautifully explained how what seeking you had and how it led you to Swamiji, but there would have been one moment for you where you would have clicked. Swamiji is my guru. This is the right, this is ultimate, he is Paramashiva. There would have been one moment. Like each of us will click. I'm sure every viewer that is watching this also, each of us will have our own unique moment. Like some will just see Swamiji's compassion, his love, his hard work. Each of us one dimension. What is that moment where you click, he is Paramashiva and he is ultimate? Like what is that one moment?
Before I met Swamiji, I shared with you many times, remember that I used to volunteer for many organizations, NGOs, where our primary focus of work was towards mentally challenged, destitute women, women who were caught in domestic violence scenarios of domestic violence, children of criminal parents. And one of the things that really flummoxes us is the suffering of human beings, whether it's me or another being. That suffering, I could see there was no solution. A lot of my friends were psychiatrists, they were counselors, they had their own practices. And I have friends who have been going for counseling and who were taking some prescribed medications. To sleep, they would take medications. But I saw that there was no permanent solution. There was one time, I think in 2008, when I was volunteering for an organization where their key focus was burnt victims. Along with them, I had visited the Burns Hospital in Chennai. And we had gone to two different wards, and the first ward was to the ladies' ward. And I saw a 23-year-old young lady. She had self-immolated herself because of a fight with her in-laws. And she had just given birth to a child who was hardly 6 months old. And because of the anger, her inability to handle the pressure, the insults, or whatever she was going through, she, in her fit of anger and fit of, basically I would say inability to heal herself, or the lack of the strength of inner space, she just took the kerosene, poured on herself and lit herself. When I saw her, she was had 98% burns. Whole body was wrapped in gauze, whole body, and the doctor was saying there was no way she can survive because her internal organs had also burnt. Actually, it was actually maybe another 24 hours they had given her. And right next to her, her 80-year-old mother was sitting with her six-month-old granddaughter. That moment, it was like, what for she would do that? She has a child, where will the child go? Even for a moment, she could not think that if my in-laws or my husband is so evil and wicked, how will they take care of my child? Who is there for my child? Even that, she did not have a sane thought. Her grief, her anger, her inability to handle all the sufferings and insults just took away the sanity of her, not only her life, her child's life. Yeah. I mean, every child would understand that without a mother and without a father, or in a society, not when you're having Swamiji in life, but in the normal society, when the mother is not there, what kind of a life the child would have, almost all of us know. That moment I was like, is there no solution for the suffering that we go through? Is there no way we can come to some kind of a permanent solution? So I was just talking to my friend who heads that NGO, Prasanna, and then we walked by and went to this children's ward. I didn't expect to find any child there unless it was by accident they had some burns or something. But I saw an 8-year-old boy who had again immolated himself. But he was in a better condition. His he had about 30% burns. I asked him, "You're an 8-year-old child. What on earth for you? You know, you would take kerosene, pour on yourself, and light fire. What made you do it?" His only reason was his mother refused to give him permission to go for a picnic with his school friends. I was so shocked. And his mother was maid servant. That was her way of economic assistance. A single mother, she was going home to home, washing vessels in people's houses, made whatever money she could. With that money, she was providing food for the children. So I said, "Boy," I was actually talking to that boy. I was like, "Don't you see your mother actually works hard the whole day just to give you basic food, and then you get angry because she doesn't send you to picnic? So what if you didn't go? I mean, what is it going to matter to you?" And the only thing, my friends make fun of me. At that moment, I also felt what kind of a society we are heading towards. where an 8-year-old child has more peer pressure and is not able to handle that anger, the feeling of being made fun of feeling of being rejected by his friends, that he decided to kill himself. So these were two, I think, very pivotal meetings that happened in my life before I met Swamiji, for which I was really seeking answers. And when I saw Swamiji, and the way he was healing people, the way he was giving, listening to people, his infinite patience with people and programs, I don't think I have ever come across anybody. I mean, I've been in my public life and I have seen so many people. I have never ever seen anybody who would spend even so much of time with strangers, with people you've never met, without having some kind of a benefit. See, even though I worked with NGOs, if you ask me what is the benefit I saw, they believed. So they felt they were, it was more like, okay, it's a cause I believe in, that I am going to help those people and I need to bring them out. So there was some kind of a satisfaction. The satisfaction was, I will not say monetary thing, but their satisfaction of having a good life was the benefit they got from doing the work. But with Swamiji, there was no any kind of a benefit that he ever got from spending endless hours patiently with people, dealing with their problems, people crying, people in such depression who would spend hours and hours just talking to him so they get healed. And many healings have happened. And the two contrary things which I saw in both was, one, Swamiji was never ever impacted by anybody's good, bad, ups, downs. He was the same. But since I have seen this side, all the NGOs I worked with, most of them were run by women who were kids, like, you know, almost we were all the same age. But after they started dealing with all the stress, each one of them started having some kind of a mental or physical problems. Now, the two of my friends who were working with mental health, one has a bipolar and one has something else. All these variable diseases that are there on the internet. And when I saw what Swamiji could, I will not even say contribute, I think any word, any English word, I'm not able to actually fit into what Swamiji's impact is on human beings. The impact of human beings that only Swamiji could ever have, and only because of his infinite patience and compassion, I was completely, there was no second thought beyond anything, that he was the ultimate guru and the ultimate incarnation, because only he can have so much of patience with human beings. There's nobody else.
Yeah, even our parents
were so at one point of time, our good friends, but never Swamiji. I've seen that.
Actually, when you were sharing about the Sakais, I remember that I have seen kids coming from countries like Malaysia where they had very luxurious life. And also I've seen kids who are drug addicts just by the age of 12 or 13, who have been literally into prisons and fights like that. But after coming to Swamiji in 21 days, literally they were able to sacrifice, I would not say sacrifice, that's not the right word actually. They were able to just get out of all of that instantly. Not having to struggle like how we go for rehab outside and nothing of that sort. Just that power of Swamiji's initiation or just that decision. That instantly everything is just cleared, and I have seen kids take krama, take the path of training to sannyas and become part of Gurukul. So, but when you were sharing these incidents, Akka, how these women had struggled in life, how these women suffered in life. When after you met Swamiji, what you expect, like you came to Swamiji for getting all your answers, but something completely unexpected happened when this entire persecution broke out, which was, it completely turned things around. The entire malicious persecution and the lies that were spread by the media, I would say it was beyond inhumane. It was an extreme of what extent violence can go to. But even in that kind of a situation, almost Swamiji's 15 years of hard work, Swamiji's contributions to humanity, everything was destroyed. So literally, the media, society, everyone were waiting to see Swamiji's mission shut down. And because they used you as a weapon, because they used your name, fame, and whatever you had as a weapon to attack Swamiji's mission, they thought that your life would completely collapse and Swamiji's mission will just shut down. But what really took, I would say, the entire humanity by a strong shock was Swamiji did not just revive the entire mission back, and Swamiji, it did not just stop with Swamiji becoming the supreme pontiff of 2 billion Hindus, but Swamiji's commitment to you as a guru, his commitment to every being, especially in spite of this worst persecution, even this could not stop Swamiji from fulfilling his commitment to you as a guru. I'm sure no one, no ordinary being can fathom such compassion. So how was this whole thing to you, right from facing this attack? How was this whole event, how did all this turn out to be, this entire turn of events? How did this whole thing happen?
Okay. Nobody can actually take any kind of insurance against such incidents, because you can never actually be prepared, and most of us don't even think it would happen to us. Given that, yes, it was a shock. It was quite, like you said, another dramatic turn of events in my life story. It happened. But there were many, many good things that happened, where like Swamiji's commitment to the disciple me at that point of time was, despite all the conflicts and so much that was the storm that was going on outside, I could feel Swamiji's presence in my life every moment of it. And that is an experience that nobody can tell you. It is, even if people tell you it's a lie, you cannot really just believe them over what your own experience is. So when it's your own experience that is much stronger and much more truthful, anything anybody says becomes irrelevant and redundant. And like you said, they were trying to use me to destroy Swamiji's mission, and what Swamiji could give to human beings, I think that is that more than me, today if I look back, I feel this is the greatest betrayal done to every being, every human being who's out there suffering and not able to experience Swamiji because of the social limitations or the social outcry that happened, which is limiting themselves or stopping them from being, just one look or one presence of Swamiji could just pull them out of suffering. But unfortunately, because of this whole media attack and the anti-Hindus and anti-Guru mercenaries who went all out to destroy Swamiji's mission using a woman. And one thing I understood was, when they use a woman, the most potent component they try to use is shame. But I was, yes, it was quite a shameful moment for my life. But one thing I was very clear on, nobody has a right to tell me how to live my life. Now I had two choices.
Actually, sorry to interrupt, but when you were talking about this, I just wanted to bring one important point here. You were saying that one important weapon they use is shaming, especially when it comes to a woman. Talking about that, given that your life, you were one of the most non-controversial heroines of your time, you were very successful in that field. But how was this whole thing to you when they used, when they completely tarnished your image, and then they used you against your own guru? And they not just destroyed Swamiji's mission, like the whole Swamiji was, it went to the extent where Swamiji was put into prison, all illegal sort of activities happened. I've seen so many women who commit suicide, even in the example you gave, who immolate themselves. So many incidents happen. Many of them succumb to the powerlessness. When it came to the extent of whom you met, the avatar that you met in your life, when you were used as a weapon against that very being itself, how did you never had that moment where you completely felt like you succumbed to the powerlessness, or how were you able to come out of it? Was that feeling, did that never cross in you?
How I was able to come out of it is, like I said, it was only through Swamiji's intense presence in my life at those moments. Yes. If you ask me if I thought of committing suicide, yes, it does pass through your mind, because it was the most shameful thing for a woman to be going through what had happened at that point of time. But shame is so potent, you can either use it as a catalyst to completely destroy your life, or use it as a catalyst to show people that you have no right to tell me how to live, or tell me what is right and what is wrong. And or you cannot tell me that I am a bad person when I am not that person. Just because you tell me, I am not going to believe it. I think these strong decisions or ideas, even though they may be in me, they would have been inside me, but what made me actually live by it is only strong Swamiji's presence, I would say. On one hand, like you said, I never ever thought I would see Swamiji again in my life. Because what has happened, anybody would not see the person, whether it has happened or not, true or not. You would not want to talk to the person who has been one of the main actors, I would say again, into a whole destruction that took place, like said, 15 years of his hard work, plus so much of conflict, pain that when the devotees went through. I never thought I would actually ever see Swamiji again. So when I again came back into the Adinam and into the Sangha and the mission, I was least expecting to be even welcomed. I thought nobody would ever speak to me ever again, and I would never get to see Swamiji. But now, of course, life is different, and all due to the grace of Swamiji. Other than that, I have no other logical or human factors contributing to this.
Okay, actually, I should say, when you are talking about it, I should tell you, when you stood up by Swamiji, even today, I cannot even compare what's happening to me to what happened, to the extent of persecution that happened to you. But really, even now, if there is one thing that, like, even when I joined newly to Gurukul, I remember the kind of conversations that we used to have. Even when Mahadev used to talk to all of us, we were always given as an example of how a person can stand up to Swamiji's mission. Even nothing should ever come our way. Like you told, you never let anyone decide or shame you. You never let anything outside affect you. Even today, that is really an inspiration for so many of us. Like we always say, if we have to stand up for Swamiji, because being Swamiji's daughters, each of us really have a dream of standing up for Swamiji's mission and being like a pillar and showing the world who Swamiji is, that he is Paramashiva. At so many moments, you are the example that we all take. Like how you decided to stand back. How do you decided to stand back and fight? Just you knew that you knew that truth. You knew you had that experience. Just with that strength and your trust and devotion to Swamiji, how you stood back. Even today, for so many of us, that chastity, that trust, that devotion is such an inspiration for all of us. Because you were talking about this, I just really wanted to share this, because be it one single comment that we see, even now, even when normal kids, when they make some Facebook post or something like that, there are lots of abusive comments that come. There are still people who have no other, you know, who waste their time trying to put us down. But at those moments, I've seen many of the times, you just remember how Akka stood up, never that affected. She always stood back with the strength of her devotion to Swamiji, and she knew Swamiji was with her. That literally, even at this point of time, when there are so many lies that the media is spreading, again, trying to attack Swamiji using me as a weapon. Really, so many times, I use you as an inspiration, and I just stand up. I just decide, I will fight back. So I just wanted to share this when you were talking about it.
That's so sweet, ma'am. But actually, Now we're talking about that. You are an inspiration for many of us. For me, every day in and day out, I only think, oh my God, how are they doing it? How are they managing? How are they able to do it? And see, at least I was much older. I had seen a lot of world. I had a very strong opinions and ideas to a lot more. But I think all that Swamiji had already taught you all in his teachings in Gurukul. That's one. But even then, just standing up the way you are, standing for what is the truth, I think requires a lot of courage and a very, very powerful inner space. That's something you have been an inspiration for. I really wanted to tell that it's not just for the interview or anything, but every day in and day out, I keep thinking of you both. How you kids are managing and what you're doing, and having the will to carry forward is immensely, what do you say, inspirational for me.
Actually, how you have been this 10 years with Swamiji, really, like you were sharing, one other thing you were sharing, okay, you were saying that when you wanted to come back, you did not expect, you never thought you would meet Swamiji back again in your life. There was such a phase. How was your decision? Because your comeback was not, you did not just normally come back and join. You took sannyas, which was a totally unexpected decision. For the amount of persecution they did to Swamiji using you, they expected you would literally, it would just shatter your life totally, like completely. But you decided to come back and take sannyas, which was totally like out of the blue, and nobody even would have thought that in their wildest imagination. And moreover, as a celebrity, right? For a celebrity, life is built around lots of, the media, the spotlight, attention, garnering the fame and a love. But sannyas is the complete opposite. You renounce everything, and literally what you have as your identity, you just renounce the whole thing. You were your own, though this persecution and all happened, you were still your own social influencer. You had your own fan clubs, your own cars, houses, your family, your bank balances, etc. But you decided to give up all of that, and then you decided to choose the lifestyle of Ahimsa, Asteya, Aparigraha, Satya and Brahmacharya, the lifestyle of sannyas. How did that decision happen? What was that moment where you decided that you will take sannyas? Was there any struggle? Did you have any inner conflict? Or how did that bridging ever happen from that life to this decision?
When I did not have an inner conflict, because I was very clear, one, that I wanted to become like Swamiji. Swamiji living the principles that he talks about. He's so integrated to the principles that he teaches. What you said, Asteya, Aparigraha, Ahimsa, Brahmacharyam. They are the most noble principles that you can first start practicing and living. And like how Swamiji is able to transform each and every individual because of his highest integrity to these principles. And Swamiji told so many times, I think in satsangs also, that he is the principle. When you see the principle of Swamiji, he is something beyond a role model. I cannot say he's a role model or, encapsulate him into the small words. And I was very clear that if I wanted to make some kind of a good contribution to the next generation after my death, that's always been my driving factor. One of my driving factors was, what am I going to leave behind? What is the good we can leave behind? I think most human beings think like that. What can I leave for my next generation? What is the good thing I can leave for the next generation? And remember earlier in this interview when we were talking, I said I was looking for that unique thing in life, which I knew I was still seeking, even though I had so many things I was keeping myself busy with. When I decided to take sannyas, I felt that puzzle has become complete. And that unique thing in life, or that what seeking I was, the vision for life. Sannyas gave me the vision for life, and Sannyas also gave me the clear path that this is it. You cannot have a plan B. The moment you have plan B, plan C, plan D, then your vision for life is not clear. You always have an option for failure. But if your vision for life is very clear without a plan B, then even through failure you will work for that success. You may fail 10 times, 15 times, but if you are very clear, this is my vision for life and I don't have a plan B, the moment we remove plan B from your life, the vision becomes so focused. And what more nobler cause you can live for in this planet than, you know, and people who have seen her mission knows, but the mission is nothing but what Swamiji has contributed for people. Our mission takes care of young pregnant women who are handheld through the emotional, psychological, physical welfare for healthy children. From that we start to healing the wounded souls. To giving empowering cognitions, liberating cognitions to people, to teaching them what your thought current is. It's actually you're empowering them. You know, they're not dependent on us. The science is so beautifully Swamiji has designed. You empower them, teach them the principles, and then they take it and they practice it. They do not have to come back to us. When you do, I really don't see anything more nobler in this planet, more nobler that the life can do, a human being can do for me personally. And I would tell this for anybody, if you ever want to leave something good for your children behind or for the next generation behind, the best thing you can do is take sannyas, because it's the most noblest of life. And only by living these highest principles of ahimsa, asteya, aparigraha and brahmacharyam, I think you can create such an immense change in the way the world is today. There is so much of suffering and violence in the world. Yes, ma'am, you want to say something?
Yes, Akka. Akka, you were talking, sannyas, like you're saying, there are so many causes that you wanted to stand for. I just got a question where you were sharing that. Because even your life before Adinam, before you came to Adinam, you still were part of so many NGOs, like you were sharing. You had met so many people. So what is the difference? Like, you could have still chosen to continue the philanthropic activities for your spiritual growth, but what is the difference between doing like what you are doing as with being part of so many NGOs and the normal contribution versus sannyas? What catalyzed your decision for sannyas, given at the time period also when you took in this whole persecution? So how did that happen? What do you see as the difference between, you know, being normally being a part of an NGO and taking sannyas? And
all right, sannyas, see, we can be outside, you can be a devotee, we can continue our philanthropic activities, charitable activities, which a lot of us do. But as I said, the sannyas gives you a complete focus on the higher causes of life. Earlier in this, a few minutes back when we were talking, I had told you like how the suffering for human beings, I have not found a permanent solution. I mean, I felt there was no solution that permanently could help people walk out of suffering till I met Swamiji. The moment I met Swamiji, and when you experience the transformation in you, I knew this, what Swamiji is doing to the world so selflessly, is the only solution for the world. And when see, the problem with words, I realized nowadays that they're so limited and you really can't express the entirety of what Swamiji is or who he is or what he's giving to people. When you see that, that's such an inspiration, how selflessly Swamiji does that higher noble thoughts. Again, noble thoughts is for a human level I'm just talking about. Those are what attracted me, and I knew this was going to be the only focus of my life. When you see such a inspiration in front of you, I think life, other choices or other lifestyles seem so small and so irrelevant, and there was no second choice in life for me. I felt this was the only thing that I wanted to do. That's the reason I took up sannyas. It's like a statement to the world. I also wanted to make a statement that I was with Swamiji because I believed in his principles, I believed who he is, and I believe that he's the only one who can make so much of change to this planet. And our relationship was more of a guru-disciple, not any of those nasty, sleazy things that the anti-Hindu media mafia came out with. So that was one of another reasons.
Also, I wanted to ask, I had another question in this aspect. One, your context of sannyas, like even now, even after your sannyas, the amount of projects that you are taken up and how many projects, so many instructions, when Swamiji gives his vision in satsang, we can see immediately you will be having so many projects regarding that, and you will be leading all the projects. Like right now, even how for the Sri Kailasa Uniting Nations for feminine empowerment and gender equality, or be it you're already the Sri Mahant that officially represents Swamiji in so many organizations, so many Hindu platforms. So while this is one aspect, how was your personal side, like with your family, how was their response? Like, was that moment of receiving sannyas, because for normal people itself, I have seen so many people, they'll have a long waiting process, a lengthy process of completion with their family. Of course, it's not going to be easy parting with the family, but especially you were sharing your whole life, you were working for your family, and you were so close to them. So how was that moment of you receiving sannyas? Was it dramatic, or how was that whole thing?
Actually, for my pre-monastic family, they were actually shocked that I would take such a decision. But as I said, I was very clear on my decision that I was not going to change it ever. And when especially my pre-monastic mother, she had become bedridden when she heard the news. But seeing my belief and strength and my clarity in my decision and the integrity to the decision, she became complete with the decision actually, and towards the end of her life she stayed in the Adinam in Bangalore, and in fact she passed away there in the Adinam. I think those were the best days of her life, which is what she was telling me, that this was the one thing that she always wanted to do, and every day she would receive Swamiji's blessings in Sarvadarshan or when he was in temple. So she was very happy, and in a way that was also another part of completion, because like I said, my career, everything was focused for the mother. And anyway, she died happily, and she always wanted to see, I think, God in person, in reality, which happened when she started living the Adinam. So that was, we had a good ending. And my another sister of mine, my pre-monastic sister, she also is a sannyasi in Nityananda order, sannyas order. I think, like I said, like I told Ma, it is your conviction that's going to convince your family. As long as they know that you are going to be happy where you are, your pre-monastic family, they are just happy with, as long as you are happy.
Akka, when you were sharing about your life, how you were brought up, how the decisions changed, how you met Swamiji. Now, when you shared those incidents where the child had immolated himself, it actually reminded me of one incident I just wanted to share with you. So once after me joining Gurukul, I finished my 10th grade, and I just wanted to connect back to one of my friends. So I very normally called her, and I was speaking to her just to connect her back and just to share with her about my lifestyle. Because they never even thought that I would become, you know, I would join such a place, or I would even take the path of sannyas. They were never, so I just wanted to share with them. So when I connected to her, both of us were 15 years old, same age. So I was sharing with her how my studies were going on, how many people I met, and by then, actually, that was the time I started manifesting power. So I was so excited and I was sharing with them. Then, so that time I asked her, very normally I asked her, how was your life going on? So she also told me, I passed all my exams and it's all fine. And then she told me that I'm very depressed because I just broke up with my boyfriend. It actually, that answer, though I knew it is very common for the world outside, it was not at all something I expected. I really, honestly, I didn't know how to react to it. Because first of all, this concept of boyfriend, girlfriend, that is not even there in our life. So like Swamiji beautifully sets the context. Till 21, we are still discovering ourselves. So when we are still not clear about our images, we will not, there is no better half concept at all. But she was really, really affected by it. So one, I was not able to see a friend whom I saw with me being so depressed. And first of all, I did not know how to respond to it for a moment. But then I realized actually there are so many people like this, teenage pregnancy and like the incidents that you had also shared, Akka. So talking about this, the world that we saw a few years back for a child, that its entire world was revolved around the parents, family. But the world today, in light of independence, feminism, liberty, and revolutionary upbringing, modernism, at a very young age, the knowledge about relationships, sex, dating, it becomes a very, it prevails a common subject of experiment, especially amongst teens. So I wanted to ask you, do you think this kind of an advancement where a child gets to be on Tinder by 14 or 15 and starts dating, or a young child gets an iPad by the age of 3 or 4, do you think this kind of an advancement, it has become, do you think it is progressive or do you think it is unnecessary? What is your view on this?
I feel they're absolutely progressive. In fact, I feel this is the best stage of for all human beings, for all of us. The world is so exciting because you have the world in your hands. Google has made the globe fit into your palms. The world of information is in your hands, literally in your palms. So that is the most exciting thing. The exciting turn of technological advancement is that where the whole world is in your hands. Any information you want is in your hands. But it is not, I think, technology dependent. Our lack of powerful inner space, powerful thought currents is more of the social fabric. It is not, if you have a powerful inner space, no matter what the situation is outside, you may have the whole world, like you said, you may have anything and everything against you, but your inner space will not falter. And especially the Hindu principles which Swamiji is reviving and working so hard the last almost 26 years to revive all the Hindu principles are an amazing gift for human consciousness. And I only realized it after I met Swamiji, started listening to his teachings and looking back and mapping his teachings to a lot of our historical or mythological stories. Especially for us Hindus, as a Hindu woman, I remember one of the things that was part of the social parlance or social conversations was, oh, women are weak, and you know, Hindu women are weak women. We have to fight like the Western world. We have to fight for our liberation, our equality. You know, we have to be equal in all walks of life, whether it's a pay or whether you're treated or the way you're respected. We have to fight, but we are still weak women. And this whole weak woman concept is part of your upbringing and conversations around you. So it does not sound that it's not true. But when after I met Swamiji and started listening to his principles of what are the liberating thought currents and what are the bondage-based thought currents, what is suffering, how we are literally living our life by consciously choosing suffering because it makes us feel good. We are not in understanding this for a long time it took me to understand. But when I started understanding and looking back, I understood that the Hindu history, especially the history of the Hindu woman, is filled with powerful women who had who are inspirational leaders, whether and they were in all walks of life, but not with the idea of feminist equality. It was not for, I'm a woman, I have to fight for my rights. I am a woman, nobody has the right to tell me I'm weak, I'm powerful, you have to treat me with respect. It was not from that space. It was from a completely powerful space. One example I really wanted to share with you was, I don't know, you may have heard of the story of Satyavan Savitri, where the wife, when the husband dies, I'm just putting the gist of it, when the husband dies, she stops the son because I think someone tells her that if you are able to fight with the Lord of Death before the sun sets and get your husband back to life, you still have a possibility that your husband might come back to life. So she's just with her integrity and chastity, she stops the sun. Then she fights with the Lord Yama, Lord of Death. Not fight in the sense, not like a war or a duel, but it's a conversational, intellectual, verbal war she has. And she convinces Yama, or she, let me say, in our today's language, she outwits him, she out-intelligences him, and makes him give her husband's life back. I've heard this story from my childhood many times, O Sati Savitri, but how I understood it was being presented from my childhood was, oh look, women are so weak. You know, she needs the husband. But when I started listening to Swamiji's teachings and his principles and the concepts of completion, powerful inner space, I understood what a powerful inner space Savitri should have had to be able to stop the sun. Even if it's a story, you know, if I teach this to the next generation, it is not that she needed the husband. It was not a need based on some emotional imbalance. It was a need because she had a lot of love and respect for him. But she took the responsibility, and with her integrity and her chastity, she stopped the weather. She changed his entire, she rewrote his future, literally. And she gave him birth. So what kind of inner space at that moment? In today's world, if anybody is grief-stricken, you forget everything else for many, many days. It takes you a long time to come back to normalcy. But this young lady, her husband is just dead. But she is not overcome with grief. She is not overcome with fear. She is not overcome with greed. She has a very clear and very chaste and integrated thought current that she is going to get her husband back to life. She is not crying, she is not asking society for help. She herself does it. That powerful inner space, instead of telling, teaching, oh look at that poor lady, she needed her husband back, so she fought and she got him back. Instead of that teaching, if this whole thing, this all the Puranas, the mythology, the concepts of life itself are taught through Swamiji's powerful cognitions, then life would be so... the planet would be so much joyful, I feel. That is one of the reasons.
Akka, when you're telling me, I'm able to resonate with it so much because I just wanted to share one small incident. So, because I feel we have such a blessing to be brought up in Gurukul with so many people who are there to continuously remind us with Swamiji's powerful cognitions. Because I still remember, this is like one of my most, I will never forget this one moment where I had come with you to Chennai. And I had one of the most silliest of doubts, I would say silliest of issue. But at that time, you just reminded me of one teaching. You were talking about powerful inner space. And at that time, you gave that example. If you, I'm sure you'll remember, you gave that example of how the mother's concern, like when the child goes next to the fire, that even though first time the mother will, when the child burns the hand, even though the child will tell the mother that I will not go again and touch the fire in the burning hand, but the mother will always keep an eye on the child just to make sure that the child is safe. And you gave very beautifully, you made me understand how Swamiji's compassion is the same. Growing up in Swamiji's ambience, that is a real freedom where we all still have devices, we make websites, but even though we have the freedom, we are never really tempted to go and do something wrong with it. And even if there's any issues, like Even if there's a small this thing, we know we have the powerful cognitions. We have right people to remind us around. Like how you spoke to me that day. Really, that was such a huge click. That was such a beautiful, powerful cognition in me. Like at the right time, you reminded about it. But at the same time, now so many people outside and kids outside, women or kids, and you were talking about feminism. One side where suicide, acid attacks, and rapes. That is happening. And on the contrary, in the name of feminism, it is becoming literally like a fight for just cerebral opportunities. Or saying, oh, you have to pay the bill, a man has to pay the bill, and women should, man has to hold the door for women. It is becoming like that. So I just wanted to ask you, what do you think exactly is the empowerment that a woman needs? What exactly is the, not just a woman, anyone, what exactly is the empowerment that people need in the society with the way it's progressing?
From my personal experience of what the last 10 years I've seen, or the life before that, I think the simple teachings of Swamiji of completion, powerful cognitions about yourself, especially this teaching of Swamiji's of completion with self-doubt and self-hatred, and and we bury it so deeply inside that comes out as violence and hatred towards others. But actually, when you apply these principles, you start understanding that it is you yourself that you start hating for various reasons which are not even relevant or even valid. And you were telling that the powerful cognition that I gave you, it is what I see Swamiji live actually. So in the last few years, everybody knows how much he's been persecuted and how many assassination attempts he has been through. Even through all this, his first concern would be for all his Gurukul kids and his sannyasis and brahmacharis. They say, no, first find out, let's find out, did they have this, did they have that, do they have enough food, do they have enough, are they protected properly? When you see that, it actually shakes your very core. It makes you believe in that much of goodness is possible. Because sometimes I feel we ourselves are in so much of trouble. Why are we, you know, having so much of concerns about others? We have too much issues to deal with, I would feel. But then on one side, though I was feeling like that, I would see Swamiji exactly the opposite way. As a normal person, if I'm going through so many issues, I would not be much concerned even about my own siblings. I would not even be, I myself have so many problems, I really can't pay much attention to all this, so just forget it. And family also, friends also will understand. But with Swamiji, it is never that. This is separate, that is separate. Absolutely. And his concern for people, devotees, their healing, no matter what intense persecution would be going on, we would be having to protect and defend so many things, including Swamiji. But if there is any devotee who is asking for healing, or any Adinavasi who needs to be healed, I have seen Swamiji spend endless hours sitting with them and talking to them, giving them powerful cognitions. And I truly believe that with Swamiji in this planet, human being suffering is extreme foolishness. There cannot be a more foolish time for humanity to suffer when Swamiji is walking on this planet. But I have seen and I have experienced just by his presence, the way he radiates himself, it brings smile on people's faces.
I remember, Raka, so many times you'll always share, when Swamiji is there, nobody, no human has a right to suffer. As when Swamiji is there on planet Earth, so many times you have always told this, that many times you have shared that as your goal. Like, when Swamiji is there, nobody should miss him. Nobody should ever miss what Swamiji has got for the humanity. It is such an inspiration for all of us, Raka. Really, thank you so much for being here today, Raka, because what questions I ask is not just for me, but so many of us have lots of questions like this, where we have learned many things from you, but we always wanted to have, you know, even more an insider's view of how you dealt in so many situations and how you have stood up for Swamiji. So really, thank you so much, Akka.
Really, I want to thank you, kids, for giving me this opportunity to talk to you, because One, I get to see you all after such a long time, so I am so delighted with that. And the only, again, I just want to have leave behind one thought current I want to leave behind after all our conversation is, this powerful inner space is the most important gift that Swamiji has given all of us. And if we are just able to teach people, I mean every human being on this planet, I think suffering would not even be in anybody's dictionary. Like you told, Numa, like for you, fear nor greed was ever in a dictionary. The word depression was not even in your dictionary, even though you're a kid who's in this today's world. That would be the world that we can create. If we all go out and teach the world the powerful cognitions and absolute confidence in yourself. It's absolute confidence. All these teachings give you the unshakable faith in your decision making, the unshakable faith in your ability and the capacity to take the right decisions in life. And that removes so much of conflict, that removes so much of suffering in life itself. I think unless individual transformation happens from the root level, from the root pattern that Swamiji shares about, from that level, unless the individual transformation happens, we talk about global transformation or global peace is just like Swamiji is we talking about, you know, fantasizing and deluding ourselves, global peace is possible without individual transformation.
Actually, Akka, be it powerful cognitions, the powerful inner space like you were sharing, and having a lifestyle without fear or greed, every bit of what you shared, I'm sure, is not a mere story that we all will remember, but it has certainly ignited a very thought-provoking conversation in each of us, not just for me. I'm sure every viewer that is watching this entire conversation with us, for each of you, there it would have provoked a very thought-provoking conversation in each of us. Because individually, for each of us, as a woman, as a child, a man, a human beings, we may face so many conflicts, so many challenges in our life. And we too will want to fight against and stand up for. And listening to you has surely ignited that passion in each of us, the strength and desire in me to discover my powerful inner space and to stand up for the mission that Swamiji has come down to give the humanity. And Akka, really, you have set such an example of the strength of a chaste woman. Because every bit of what you shared, it is not just a story, Akka, it is not just your experience, but the context, the strength, the devotion, the chastity and integrity that you have. And actually, all the viewers, I can resonate with each of you. That sparkling inspiration in each of you waiting for your personal journey to discover your powerful inner space. Really, thank you so much, Akka, for sharing. I would never forget this moment in my life. I'm so happy that I, out of all, got a chance to have this conversation with you and have show a new perspective to the world about what a chaste woman can do. Thank you so much, Akka.
Thank you, Ma. Shall we finish with the Purna Mantra?
Yes, Akka. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavasishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Hari Om Tat Sat Sarvam Bhagavat Sri Nityananda Paramashiva Padukarpanamastu Om Nityanandam.
Nityanandam Akka, thank you so much for this wonderful, exciting interview. I wouldn't even say it was an interview, it was a beautiful rendezvous with you. And we...
शिवोऽहम् ॐ नित्यानन्द परमशिवोऽहम् ॐ नित्यानन्द परमशिवोऽहम् ॐ नित्यानन्द परमशिवोऽहम्
शिवोऽहम् ॐ
परमशिवोऽहम् ॐ नित्यानन्द परमशिवोऽहम् ॐ नित्यानन्द परमशिवोऽहम् ॐ नित्यानन्द परमशिवोऽहम्
Shivoham. Om आनंद परम शिवोहम ओम नित्यानंद परम शिवोहम
Shivoham.
शिवोऽहम् ॐ नित्यानन्द परमशिवोऽहम्
परमशिवोऽहम्